We have a kind of interesting situation for a review today, something that hasn't happened to me before. So I have on my wrist here a Neminus Xtreme Diver 300, which is a prototype. There will be some differences with the production. And I've had this watch for, I don't know, maybe 3 weeks now. And it's a really nice watch. I'm really enjoying it. But the creator forgot to tell me he's up on Kickstarter already, so I was kind of waiting for this to go up on Kickstarter, then I was going to release the review, and here I am browsing Kickstarter today, and there it is, and there's like 1 day, maybe 2 days left, roughly 48 hours or so on the Kickstarter campaign. There's still spaces available on the Super Early Bird. It's definitely a successful campaign, so this one's going to go through. So I thought I'd quickly get this review out, which is interesting. I normally get a notice from the Microbrand, and I think I know what happened. To cut a long story short, I've done reviews for Neminus before. They're a great brand. My relationship with them in a minute. And I made some suggestions for some improvements to this prototype that he accepted, and they're actually going to have in the production version. So I was kind of thinking there might be a second prototype, and for whatever reason, maybe he got busy, maybe he thought he'd let me know, maybe he did let me know and somehow didn't get the message, but whatever it is, I just didn't hear about it being up on Kickstarter, which is a real pity because I could have put this out like the day that this launched. And so here we are, a quick last minute review, one that I've been building up to for a few weeks, and I've really been enjoying this watch. So let's get stuck in and talk about pros and cons as always. And I'll get into my relationship first while I kind of already have the watch already, but to give you an idea of the boxing, that kind of thing, this was just a packaging box that it came in. I don't think that's of particular interest to people, but it's comes with a watch roll, so that this will be of interest to people. So you got a watch roll like this, probably PU leather, which is fairly typical. A lot of brands are doing this now, like Zelos do this and several other brands, and I find these really convenient. You can put several watches in there, multiple straps, travel with it. It's soft, which is good if you're going to pack it with other stuff in a bag or something, yet it's still well protected. So it's always nice to see this rather than those big wooden watch boxes that sit on a shelf and pretty much do nothing. Zip compartments, you might have a tool, like a spring bar tool. And the watch I've got on my wrist, but it does come with three pairs of straps, so we'll get these out. I actually haven't worn it on these because I've just completely fallen for the canvas strap it comes from. I mean, look wise, it's a tall watch, so this is not a dressy strap by any means, but it is an extremely comfortable canvas. It is leather backed. This one kind of was beaten up. It's a prototype, probably been worn a lot for some period of time, been out in the wars a little bit. But I found this to be exceptionally comfortable. The watch is a tall watch, so it's extremely well built, nice solid case. It's a little bit on the heavy side, nothing too extreme, nothing more than I would expect. So you want a nice thick strap like this if you're going to wear it with a strap. A lot of my canvas straps don't tend to fold very easily. You'd have to kind of shape them on a watch roll first or something similar on a watch cushion. But this one was super comfortable since day one, and I'm happily worn this out for hikes. It's kind of getting hotter weather now. Obviously, with COVID-19, I'm being very careful and keeping away from people. But to exercise, I will walk in the countryside well away from anyone, never get to see anyone. Around the coast here, there's a couple of cliff-like places I go walking on. So I'm, sweaty. I'm a somewhat chubby guy. And this has been super comfortable throughout, and has been a watch I've definitely enjoyed wearing, and I'm really happy I got sent this one because I particularly think this colored on the dial goes well with a lot of different clothes that I wear, casual clothes, as it's a tool watch. But you've got some yellows in there, kind of golden yellow, you've got some orange, you've got some red. So this is a kind of a light red shirt with some, I guess, some black in it, which is a common color that I wear. But you could wear this with orange, you could wear this with yellow, you could wear this with red, or with black. So it's a good summer color, but it's pretty versatile. And when I look at watches, I'm usually trying to pick a watch that complements my wardrobe. So I might have two or three reds, two or three blues, two or three greens. And this one really appealed to me because the color is pretty versatile. So it might not be a particularly common reason for picking a watch. I like watches that are different, and I definitely fell in love with this style when I was seeing some renders of it. So I was really happy I got this one to review. So let's get stuck in with some of the details and dimensions and so on. And we'll talk about Kickstarter, because if you are interested in this watch, there's like a couple of days left on it. That's it on Kickstarter. The retail price, it is a Salita NH. Salita. Sorry. This is what happens when I do live reviews and it's at the end of the day and it's tired, I make a mistake. It's a Seiko NH35A, so it's a very common movement, extremely reliable movement. It hacks, it hand winds, something like 38-40 hour power reserve on it. But it's a movement you see in a lot of micro brands because it's fairly affordable yet extremely reliable. So it's a great movement to have. But maybe my first little niggle with this will be the full retail price, $699. And sometimes you have brands, you know, this dial would have cost a fair amount of money. It's a 3D dial to produce. It's not just a printed dial. He's gone to a lot of extremes. Even the buckle has this wave pattern on it, which is nice to see, signed buckle. So, I mean, without getting into all the details, there's a lot on this watch that would have added to the cost. But still, $699 is more expensive than a number of Swiss dive watches that are 300 meters or better, or 500 meters. So, you know, you don't base a watch just on the price of the components. There's a certain value and a certain value on, how should I put it, the aesthetic, the style that can carry a premium on a nice design. And also the more parts that you have that are custom, like this is, you know, custom machine case. So they have to go and do a mold for that, and then, you know, and other features as well. So when you start looking at custom dials like this, then it starts to add to the cost, but still $699, pretty high for a retail price. However, the Kickstarter price is extremely good, vaguely 50% off. So there is one available right now on the Super Early Bird, which is 53% off. That's $337. And then there's also tons available on the Early Bird, 49% off, which is $359. So you're looking at $340 to $360 on Kickstarter. And that is an extremely good price for what you're getting, because you're getting a really well-built 300-meter dive watch with a lot of unique features on it, which is part of the hallmark for Neminus. I mean, just talking about my relationship with Neminus really quickly. So I've reviewed all their previous models. I reviewed the Neminus Spaceman, which was a really interesting series of dive watches based on a space exploration theme, and had 3D printed picture of the Earth or Mars or the Moon on the dial. And I fell in love with that one so much, I actually, probably like the next year, contacted him, said, do you have any left? And he did. And then I ended up buying all of them, all of the Earth and all of the Mars versions, to put in the Microbrand store, because I completely fell for that one when I was reviewing it. So definitely I'm a fan of Neminus. They have a lot of unique designs, and that's one of the things that appeals to me in a Microbrand. Yeah, I don't want a cookie cutter Rolex clone or something similar. I want something that has unique features. Somebody's put a lot of heart into the design. Sometimes they can be a little bit out there, a little bit wacky. I think the last one I reviewed for Neminus did have one issue that was really niggling me. The height on it was something like 20 millimeters, super high, which I pointed out. So I definitely will give the pros and the cons, and I see they've addressed that on this one. This one is really nice. I've measured it at 15.9 millimeters tall. On the slightly domed sapphire crystal here from the base of the screw-down crown. I think they're actually reporting it at 15.4, but I had it at 15.9 on my calipers. But, you know, under 16, that's really nice for a 300-meter diver with 4-meter-thick double-domed sapphire crystal glass. Double-dome's great. It means that there's going to be less, distortion on when you're looking at it and trying to read the lens, which is really good, and obviously thick because it's a over-engineered dive watch, pretty much. It even has a helium escape valve, though you can argue whether that's actually necessary unless you're going to be a pro diver. It's still a nice thing to see. So just talking about the watch, the price on Kickstarter, I would buy this in a heartbeat for sure. I like this watch. I'm actually tempted by the Kickstarter, but I might make him an offer on this one, to be honest, because it's a prototype and the final Kickstarter design is going to be better. But I like the kind of story behind a watch more than anything. So to get like version, and this one is 000 on the back, as opposed to, you know, 001 or 005 or whatever the number might be. And to have one that's different to every other one because of the production differences, I'm kind of tempted to see if he'll accept that. So I'm somebody who's interested in buying this watch for personal use. So that should give you an idea of how much I like it. So in terms of the rest of the features, obviously it's a ceramic insert, so that's pretty scratch resistant. It's the equivalent to the sapphire glass in terms of hardness. So that is what I want to see on any watch these days that has a rotating bezel. I know some still aluminium, so that's or steel, which is nice to see. 316L stainless steel case. It's got drilled lugs all the way through, which is really nice if you want to use a third-party strap that doesn't have a quick release. These very comfortable straps do have quick release pins, so I can literally pull this down, take it off. It's so easy. And I'm doing this through a camera, so excuse me if I try and feel my way rather than look. But you know, you should be able to put that in as well. This is where I screw up on the camera live. I'm going to have to take this off the camera for a few seconds and just so I can see what I'm doing, and then I'll put this back in. Just a little camera lens here. So yeah, it clicks in place really easily. I put it in and out twice just to make sure. Didn't take me very long, just pretty difficult to see what I'm doing on the camera there. So first thing I noticed about this, some of you like skeleton and skulls in particular. It's a very nice, deep, looks like it's an oil-pressed case back design. Very interesting. All in keeping with the theme of the watch, this is called the Neminus Xtreme because it's referring to the extreme risks that some professional divers take, and that's the story behind this watch. There's three versions available. I'll pop them up on the screen, some images of them. There's this one, which is the marine, which is kind of marine salvage diver. So they kind of go down, maybe the dive wrecks, that kind of a thing, just to rescue stuff, or basically salvage stuff from shipwrecks and so on. So that can be pretty risky in itself. So that's one risky dive job. And this is the red kind of colored dial with a lot of gold flakes and other interesting features on it. There's one called a deadhead logger black, which is to do with pulling up logs from underwater. And again, that's extremely high risk as well. And the third one is a more yellow dial. It's kind of a yellow honeycomb dial. And that's a nuclear reactor diver. So a diver has to take risks and dive in a nuclear reactor just to fix things in there. So it's a pretty interesting career for anybody doing any of those three jobs. For myself, I'm not so much into those three stories. I do appreciate that's where they're coming from and the theming for the design. But really, I'm just enjoying the watch just because I like the look of it. And that, for me, is more than enough. So also talking about the theming, I mentioned the skull on the back, screw down crown, of course, with an Neminus logo. And you've got a very nice action on the bezel. This one has absolutely no back play. I will say it does sound a little weird, extremely loud, compared to all the other divers I've had before from Neminus. So hopefully you can pick up on that noise a little bit on the camera. But there's absolutely no back play. In fact, I'm probably overturn that a little bit. It's easy enough to grip. And I'm looking through the camera lens here again. And I'm in my office, so we're almost there. Yeah, maybe could be one more, but I think that's, yeah, that looks like it's in the right spot. So it's a very easy to use, no back play on the bezel. It does sound a little weird, and I can hear both the kind of, not quite springs, but the bent pins that stop the back play pinging up a different position. So maybe this one's slightly off. It's a prototype, so I wouldn't be too bothered about that. I've handled a ton of Neminus watches now, one of the advantages of running a watch store. I will not be stocking this one, by the way. I do like it a lot. But we're kind of have invested already quite heavily for the next quarter, and can't stock everything that I like, unfortunately. But definitely, I'm interested in this watch and interested in getting this for myself. So you've got the nice bezel action. You'll notice that the date window here, which is very nicely balanced, set at 6 o'clock, looks like it's color coordinated with the dial. That's actually not the case. He's got a really interesting kind of wrist design that he's really thought through. So all the odd numbers are red background, all the even numbers are black, and I think 31 may be green. So it's like a roulette wheel. So you're taking risks. So if I unscrew the crown here, which is nicely protected on the crown guard, we'll just pop out, pull to the first position. I should be able to change the date. This one is a prototype. I see it's all red. Let's look at 31. Yeah, so everything on here is red. I actually prefer it like this in terms of looks because it is a red dial. But I do believe in the final production version, you're going to have that roulette wheel effect, which is fun. It's a fun factor. And black won't look too bad because you've got a black bezel on all of these watch designs. So black and red should work pretty nicely, I think. Obviously, you can see we have pencil hands. It's all loomed. Everything is BGW9. This is daylight, but just to give you an idea, I'm going to use this UV light here. See if it can light it up. I can see pretty well because it's glowing away, but the camera lens might not pick up on it. But anyway, the entirety is loomed on the all the markings on the bezel, and the features you'd expect, the indices are loomed as well as the hands. One thing I don't like is the full white color on the Trident. I like the Trident design, but I'm not a fan of the full white color. I would have preferred to see like a stainless steel finish. In keeping with the edges on the pencil hands, I think that looks a little bit more elegant. And you still would have the white lume in the arrow. The red tip, some people are going to like that. For me, I would have preferred just to see kind of the stainless extension the whole way through there. That's just personal taste talking, though. It's a really nice design. It's not your cookie cutter, which is what I really don't want to keep away from. So other features you may have noticed there. Right now there is a Neminus logo between the two lug ends. That is going to change. And on this side you'll have the serial number. In this case it's 00 of 99, which means there's only going to be, it sounds like there's only going to be 100 of each color made, or 99 of each color. And it says no fear on the side, which is part of the theming. So this kind of gets us into some of the changes that I was discussing with him, because initially I noticed this and I had two thoughts. One thought was, well, not everybody is going to want to, have this theme kind of branded on the side. They want to have an interesting watch, but they might, this no fear. For some people, it may be a little bit corny. For others, they're going to be really kind of digging the design. It's kind of a love or hate it thing. So I was kind of not enjoying this, but also I noticed it's not actually centered. So the gap from the edge of the lugs to the just before the N is much wider than the gap from the edge of the lugs here to just after the R. So it's not centered, and if it was centered, that might put it particularly close to the helium escape valve. So I came up with a suggestion, and he's decided to accept that for the final production version. So the helium escape valve is now going to be centered here, right in the middle, and the no fear is going to go where Neminus is, because it does say Neminus on the dial. I think it's kind of overkill to have that twice. So the no fear is kind of there for people who are wearing the watch on their wrist. It's something you can look at and enjoy, and it's kind of more discreet. And then I think this is going to be a much nicer design, very balanced, equally balanced, with the helium escape valve right in the middle. And I've suggested that if the case is brushed as it is, that this chamfered edge becomes polished. And that's going to really accentuate the curve here. I might have another watch, just coincidentally, I didn't plan it this way, just laying around that has that feature. Yeah, because I was wearing this one yesterday, that's why I know. So this one here, totally different design. These are our Ocean Crawler GMTs. And then basically, this is also called the Ocean Crawler Crawl Diver, another one we carry in the store. But you've got a helium escape valve right in the middle, and you've got a polished chamfered edge, which really accentuates the curvature on the case, which is one of the nicest things about this design. So I love the curving on the case, and I think that is really going to be an improvement on the watch. So really happy to see that he's willing to do that. And I think for anybody that might find no frill, a bit too much in your face kind of a thing, having it on the side here is more discreet. But for those that enjoy it and appreciate the kind of high risk design of the watch, they're going to like that too. All the lume is Swiss Superluminova BGW9. It's pretty strong. I might put up some lume shots when it gets dark here. It's daylight at the moment. It's kind of getting darker. So we'll talk about dimensions. The lug width is 22 millimeters. And the dimensions of this watch are supposed to be a 44 millimeter diver. Right now I have 7-inch wrist. If I was wearing it tight, that would be 17 centimeters. I like to wear a little loose, about 18. Normally have 7.5-inch wrist, but lost a lot of weight recently doing those hikes. So it wears really well on a 7-inch. As you can see, I've got it tight on my wrist right now, and there's still a little bit more extra room. Probably wouldn't want to go under 7 inches on this. So it's a super nice fit. I found it very comfortable. The holes on this don't just stop here, they go right up to here. So I'm probably using like this hole. So you could wear it on a smaller wrist if you didn't mind it being slightly oversized. I think 7 inches is probably the ideal size as a minimum size to really look good. And it will certainly look good on a larger wrist, obviously. You know, 7.5-inch, 8-inch wrist shouldn't be a problem. There's plenty of room on these straps. So this strap is a little bit shredded, but that's how I received it. But it's incredibly flexible given the fact that it's leather lined. Possibly the leather may crack a bit, but that's okay. It just helps with the comfort factor, and it's a casual look that actually the red goes really well with the red around the chapter ring that's inside the watch case, and also the red on the dial and the red tip. So, you know, nice accents in terms of the colors. Definitely a watch I'm enjoying a lot. And a nice brushed finish on the it's got a little bit of shine on it, but it's still brushed. You can see the brush lines on the bezel insert, and you've got radial brushing on the sides of the lugs here. The sizing. So getting back to the sizing. So it's kind of interesting because this curving on this case means it's a different size no matter where you measure it. The bezel itself actually works out, including the crown, from the side of the case to the end of the crown, because you've got these very thick crown guards here. Is 47.4 millimeters. Obviously, you tend to measure a watch without. If I'm just measuring bezel to a bezel without anything else, then it's 41.8, so almost 42 on the bezel itself. So you could argue that's 42. The very tips here, it's 30.9, or roughly, you know, just under 31. Millimeters on the outer edge here. So it varies from almost 40 to, if you include the crown, 47. So 44 is somewhere in the middle. I'll give them the 44, but it's, you know, the nature of this case shape, I couldn't really get 44 anywhere when I was trying to measure that. So something to keep in mind. But what really counts is the size from the lug to lug length, because how wide your wrist is, how long your wrist is, but how wide your wrist is what counts on a watch size. Other sizes are usually indicative. And the I'm just checking my notes here, if I can find this. I did measure that at some point. Of course, I didn't have that to hand. This is a live review here. I think it was like 48 millimeters or 50 millimeters. Just a sec, I've got that somewhere or other. You know, I'll put that in the comments. So I'll put a comment in there with that information so we don't lose that out. So I'm liking the design a lot. Obviously, it's a nice watch, 300 meter water resistance, just move these. You know, the action is pretty decent, but it's exactly what I'd expect for a Seiko movement. So Seiko is a great movement. See, it hacks. Let's just move this out of the way so you can read the text here. Neminus, I'm trying to read this without looking through the camera. Neminus Diver, 1,000 feet, 300 meters automatic. So it's nice. I love it. Probably not much more to say. I'm liking the angular look of this design. I think a mix between polished and with each side being brushed will add a lot more to the dial if they polish both the chamfered edges. A centered helium escape valve, the no fear in here instead of a Neminus, and your serial number on the case itself rather than the screw down case back. These are all really nice features that I like to see. And it does say Diver's Collection Limited Edition. And when you see limited edition and a serial number, that's always something that I want to watch out for on a limited edition watch. Some of the limited edition watches, including some that we've been selling, don't actually have the numbers on the watch. And then I always wonder, I have to keep a careful eye on some of my suppliers, are they actually producing more than they're saying? And, you know, because you could do another production run, really, and nobody would be any the wiser. But I like these when it's 100 of each color, like 300 in total. That means it's going to be a pretty rare watch. And that's part of the appeal of Microbrand watches. I can get a fairly affordable watch that's got a lot of unique design features, and there's only 100 of them out there. So I'm going to have something that probably a lot of other people don't have. So loving this watch, probably got everything covered that I wanted to cover on this review. It's a little bit slapdash, so my apologies for that. This also will work well with some great aftermarket straps. I have some carbon fiber straps with red stitching on them. Those will go extremely well with this kind of design because it's kind of more modern, a little bit more aggressive. And, you know, there's a lot to enjoy in this watch. And the fact that he has even gone as far as putting a wave pattern on the buckle here is super nice. Let's take a look at the other two straps while we're here. So these I've not worn just because I'm personally don't tend to wear rubber straps much. I usually wear them on leather because I'm a desk diver, but super flexible rubber strap. Exactly what I'd like to see. Looks pretty decent. No complaints with that. Again, you have a spare buckle. And when you have two buckles, one with a thicker tang and one with a thinner tang, that automatically tells me I'm going to be doing great with some aftermarket straps if I want to go for them, because if I'm not going to wear my rubber, I could probably pick up a watch and move that buckle onto that. And then we have a, I guess that's the dive strap, because the NATO style strap here, which looks like it's not been unboxed before. Oh, it has been, because it's been worn quite a bit. But this is a red dyed leather strap. So it's a NATO strap. I think that could look pretty decent as well. Though I'd be inclined to stick with a dark strap just to make the dial pop. So I'd probably stick with a black strap on this if it was me. But again, that's my personal choice. Curious to hear what you would do. Let me know in the comments. If you have any questions, do let me know. If you like the watch, keep in mind you've got like 48 hours on the Kickstarter. I would do the following. If there is the super early bird available, and there was one literally just before I did the review, you know, perhaps somebody tends to cancel towards the end, a few people do. If you get one of those and you see it and you're kind of thinking about this watch but want to sleep on it a day or so, go book it, go reserve it. You're not going to be paying until the campaign closes, and you can come back tomorrow and just cancel your pledge. So go get yourself that slot, think about it, and if you decide to go ahead, the nice thing is you don't have to wait 30 days for the campaign to close. It will be closing in the next couple of days. Funds typically clear about a week after that, and then Neminus would typically go ahead and order the production run. So this is not their first campaign. They've definitely been a really great company for me to deal with in terms of a vendor that I carry in the store. They've been very responsible dealing with customers, so could thoroughly recommend them. And Perry, the gentleman behind the brand, I also deal with him with one other brand as well. It's not his brand, but another brand that he's involved with. I've known him for a couple of years now. And, you know, I've been working with him solidly for the last year and a half at least. So I definitely could recommend this brand as a decent brand. They've looked after their customers and they keep coming up with these interesting designs. I really want to see what they're going to do next. And that's it. The Neminus Xtreme Diver 300. Thanks for watching. Take care.